Hi guys, it's Angie, and today I'm going to show you how to make a snake scarf. A snake scarf is just a tube scarf that I've made into a snake by adding eyes and a tongue. So anyway, this is a finished one, and so the way I make mine mostly is on the small Addy knitting machine, but you can also make them on a small round loom. And there are several people that don't have the knitting machine, so I figured I would, and also by request, show you how to make it on a small round loom. This is the loom I'm going to use today. This is a Nifty Knitter loom, and I believe it has 24 pegs. Yes, it has 24 pegs. The Addy machine has 22 pegs, and then there's Cindy Wood looms, makes a small round loom. I think she calls hers a slipper sock loom, and it has even more pegs. It doesn't really matter. You can still make a tube with just any round loom. There's even the flower loom that you can make a tube with that would be, it would just be skinnier. It's like if you get a bigger round loom, the snake is going to be wider, and the smaller you go, the more it won't be as wide. So what you need is a round loom, some yarn, of course. My favorite kind of yarn to use to make a snake scarf is, hold on a second please. I'm really sorry about my dog barking like that. I'm not like a professional YouTuber, so I don't do a whole lot of editing and stuff, so I apologize for any interruptions. Going back to what you need, a round loom, some yarn. My favorite yarn for snake scarves is, I love this yarn from Hobby Lobby, and but really any kind of a variegated or striping yarn. This is in the color Morning Glow, and it says it's a print, but it comes out with a really good stripe. So I'm gonna use this yarn. You also need a loom hook. If you're just getting into loom knitting, most loom sets come with a really skinny hook, and to me that's really kind of hurts my hands. So I bought this. It's by Knitting Board, and you can get them on like Amazon. You can get it straight from knittingboard.com, but where I get them, and I have several, is from Joann's, and they're I think $3.99, and it's got a nice thick ergonomic handle, so I really like that a lot. You'll also need some yarn for the tongue on your snake, and the tongue on the snake is just a chain stitch, a crocheted chain stitch, and I'll show you how to do that too. And of course you need a crochet hook, and the one that I like to use is a 5mm or an 8. Says USH 8 5.00mm. That's the one I think makes the best tongues. And then you're also going to need a yarn hook or a tapestry needle. And you can get them in plastic and metal. I prefer the metal ones. So these are the ones that I have. By Clover, and they come in these nice little cases, and I have a different one too that are curved, but for the snake scarf you can use any kind of a yarn needle works. And you also need some eyes. This is my collection of eyes that I use for the snake scarves, so for the little eyes. So I'll show you. I'm gonna move the camera, and hopefully I can find a good angle to show you how to cast on and start your snake scarf. So, I'm going to adjust the camera here. And again, like I said, I don't do a whole lot of editing, so I hope this will work. Okay, I think that's going to be a good angle. So let's get started. I'm going to take the label off my yarn because for the scarves, or actually for anything that I do, I don't like to do the center pull because sometimes there's knots in there and you don't find them until later. So I'm gonna try to find where the yarn starts from the side. Okay, so I'm gonna pull it out like that. And then I'm gonna throw it down on the floor. So the first thing, you're on the loom, you'll see there's this little peg right here. And this is what's called an anchor peg. And you use that at the beginning of your project. And I'll show you later, we'll go ahead and release the yarn from there. But the first thing you're gonna do is make a slip knot. And there's a lot of different ways to make a slip knot. There's all kinds of videos on YouTube for it. And I'll show you the way that I do it that to me is the easiest. But I'm gonna use my pointer finger and I'm gonna wrap the yarn around like this. And then I'm just gonna take this first one and loop it over the back one and then pick it up and loop it again. And then I've got a slip knot. And I'll show you that again. So just loop it twice and then kind of just hold on to it with your other finger. And then just take the first one, loop it over the back one, and then the back becomes the first one. You pick it up, loop it again, and then pick up the front one. And that makes a slip knot. So you take that slip knot and you put it on the anchor peg and tighten it up. Just like that. And then what we're going to do is cast on. We're going to cast the yarn onto this loom and make our first row. So the way you do that is starting with the first peg, it's like here's your anchor and then here's your first peg. We're just gonna take the yarn and loop it around. See how I did that? You go in the back of the peg and loop it around. We're gonna do that all the way around the loom. And I'll go really slow for you. Just go all the way around. Just keep on going. Then I like to kind of hold the yarn as I'm going in a few spots because I've had it where I'm going to loop the yarn around and I accidentally let go and it all comes off the loom. And then see, here's, we're to the last peg, and you can tell because you've got the yarn wrapped here. Now since this is our cast on row, we're gonna loop around another time. So you start again, and then see how I'm putting this yarn a little closer up to here? That's because when we're done with this one, we're gonna yarn over. We're gonna take this piece of yarn and we're gonna put it over the top of that one. So you just do just like you did, from back to front, back to front. And you just loop it around like that. And if you already know how to cast on a round loom, or a loom for that matter, you can always fast forward. Okay, so we've made it all the way around now, and you can tell you're all the way around because here's the first peg again with the two on it, and then I just take the yarn and kind of put it over here and then hold it with my thumb on the bottom of the loom. See, there's the top. And here's the bottom. I'm just going to hold on to it. You don't have to hold it for too long. I've seen in some videos where people start yarning over, starting over here, and then they're having to struggle with holding that yarn. Well, I start over here because then I can let this go. So you're going to take your loom hook and take this bottom piece of yarn and put your loom hook through it and loop it over the top. And I'll keep showing you that so you can see how I just looped it over. Now, you might notice the first one, when you went to loop it over, was a little tight, and that's normal. The other ones will feel a little bit looser. And the idea is, and see, now I can actually let this go and it's not gonna unravel. And just keep going. And when you're wrapping the loom, just try not to do it really super tight. And I'm gonna do several rows so you can see how I do it. And I'm just gonna keep going around and yarning over. And this is actually gonna make our first knit row. And basically what this snake scarf is just a long tube. And see, and then I'm back to the beginning again. I just have one row. This is what it looks like on the inside. And then I'm just gonna take and push this row down a little bit. I'm not gonna put it all the way to the bottom because then it makes it a little harder when you yarn over. So I'm just gonna kind of push it down to about the middle. Just go all the way around, pushing it down. Now, if you were making a project where you needed to count your rows, this would be the time, you know, after you're done knitting over the whole thing, where you would either want to write down a tick mark or use a counter, you know, something to tell you how many rows you have. So that would be row one. So now we're going to do the second row. On a snake scarf, what I do is I use an entire skein of yarn. That I love this yarn is 252 yards. It's just personal preference. When it gets to a length you like, then you stop. It's just completely personal preference. So now we're going to start with our second row, and we're going to do the same exact thing, except we only have to go around one time because we already have yarn on here. So I'm going to start with this first peg right next to the anchor peg, and I'm going to go back to front again, all the way around the loom. Back to front, back to front, back to front. Going all the way around. And again, I'm kind of holding the yarn, you know, a little bit. And you notice I'm just easily going around. I'm not like pulling it tight or anything. I'm just going around without using a whole lot of tension or pressure. So now I'm to this one, the end again. So again, I'm going to pull my yarn down and hold it with my thumb on the bottom of the loom. And starting with this peg here, I'm going to yarn over. And again, the reason I don't start over here is because you'd have to hold this yarn all the way till you got all the way to the end again. So I start with the end. And then it secures that yarn for me. And again, this first one usually is a little tighter than all the rest. And then yarn over, and you can go ahead and let go of that, because if I started here and then I let go, the whole thing is going to come unraveled. So that's why I just start from the back and just go around. And if you hear any tippy tappy, that's my dog. He has his own Facebook page. He's not that great at posting lately, but his Facebook page is Nate the Dog. His name is Nathan, and we call him Nate, or Natey, or Natey Potatey. I love cats too, but my husband's allergic. So you just keep yarning over. And some people will come from the top and go over, but I struggle with that, so I go from the bottom. So we're to the end again, so then you just go, just like we did before, and push the yarn about halfway down. And again, if you're doing counting, you would click your counter, and this is row two. And the reason I mention about counting is, say for example, you were making a headband, and I'll try to maybe show you that too. You would use 90 rows. You'd do 90 rows. So we made it all the way around. That's what it looks like on the inside. So we're going to go around again. And I'll do this a few times so you can get the hang of it. And if you don't want to watch that many times, you can just fast forward. So again, we're going to start with this peg that's just right here from the anchor peg. And starting from the back, back to front, and you're looping all the way around that peg. And I'm not like pulling it to make it tight or anything. I'm just very relaxing, just looping it around, letting it run through my fingers. I'm not trying to be really tight with it or anything. Just going around the whole loom again, back to front, back to front. You're just starting on the back of the peg. And then I'm to the end again. I can tell because here I'm back at the beginning and I've seen the two. So I just take that yarn, come in front of that peg, and then I'm gonna hold it with my thumb. And again, we're gonna do just like we've done before and yarn over. And this first one's a little tighter than all the rest of them. And you can go ahead and let go of the yarn. When I very first started loom knitting, I would go like the videos that I had seen where they started over here and trying to hold that, especially if you're trying to do a hat or something on a bigger loom, and trying to hold that yarn while you're going all around is really pretty awkward. And so that's why I decided to start and go this way instead. And it works, and I've made probably hundreds of hats that way, and so I know the technique works without messing anything up. See, I like to go from the bottom and pull it over, but it's just all in the way. Like I said, you can start at the top and pull it over, but I prefer going at it from the bottom over. And then we're to the end again, so push it down. At this, and then if you're doing a counter, you would, since you just got done with the row and now you're just pushing it down, you would click your counter. And then we're back to the beginning again. At this point, if you want to, you can go ahead and release this. This is called an anchor peg because it's holding on to the yarn at the very beginning of the project for you. And so you don't really need it to hold the yarn anymore because you've done several rows of knitting. So usually, kind of towards the beginning, I go ahead and release it, and you can just take it off the peg. Let's see, it's just right there, and then you can just pull it through the bottom. Don't cut it off because we're going to be using it later. So then it's just going to kind of hang there, and it doesn't matter if the slip knot pulls out. It's just going to hang there and be there for us to use later. So I'm going to do one more row, and then I'm going to pause the video and do some more. But I figured one more row should hopefully be enough to show you the concept. So again, we're going to start from right here and start on the back of the peg and go around. And I'm making this video geared towards people that are new to loom knitting. I know, and I want to tell you about a channel too, that if you're new to loom knitting, or not new, but you want to learn some new stitches and techniques and how to do things, there's a channel called Pam Loomer. And Pam isn't currently posting any more videos to it, but she's kept it up because she knows how much people like that channel and use it and learn from it. But I learned so much from her. Back to front. And she does have an active channel that's like, you know, vlogging and sharing projects and that kind of stuff. And it's Pam Chaff, or no, Yarny Nana. Yarny Nana. Okay. So back to front. And see, here we're at the beginning again. So I'm going to pull through and hold it with my thumb and then yarn over. Another channel that's really good with just teaching different techniques, not always loom knitting, but just a very interesting channel, is Margaret Olander. And she's where I learned how to use the Addie machine to make the snake scarves, because she has some Addie tutorials. So if you have a knitting machine, then she's a good channel. And I'll try to remember to put links below. So I'm just going through and yarning over. And then we have another row completed. So I'm gonna just go through and push them down to the middle, because then I'm ready for my next row. And again, if you were counting rows, that would be a completed row. So you would either mark your little tick mark or use your counter. Now you'll notice as you go through here, because I'm gonna pause the video here in a second and I'm gonna keep knitting and then I'll come back. This will start to come out through the bottom and you'll see it will look like a tube. And you may even notice the ends will kind of curl up. Don't worry about that. None of that's to worry about. And I'm gonna knit some more so I have some coming out the bottom so I can show you what it looks like. And you're gonna have this, you know, your little tail down here, and it's just gonna keep coming out, and you'll notice it's a tube. So I'm gonna pause it here, knit a few more rows, and I'll be back. Okay, I think I've knitted enough to give you an idea of what it looks like and everything, and so that I could get a video out to you quicker, I have another tube that I'm gonna finish the snake off with, and I'm gonna use this to show you, you know, how it looks a little bit different from what you knit on the Addie machine. And I also want to show you how you get it off the loom. So the first thing I'm gonna do is get it off the loom, show you how to do that. So what you're gonna need for that is a needle, like a tapestry needle, and I actually prefer the ones that are a little bit curved, but this still will work. And so I need enough yarn to go all the way around here, so I'm kind of just going to take what yarn I have and loop it around my loom, because that's going to be, I'm going to loop it around a couple times just to make sure I have enough yarn. And then I'm gonna cut the yarn. And thread my needle. And a tip, if you fold the yarn in half, kind of just fold it like that, it's easier to push through the needle. Okay, so then I have the needle threaded. And this is the yarn that I ended with. So when I was doing my pegs, it ends right there. And so what you're gonna do is start threading it through each of these. So I'm gonna start with my first peg and just take this and thread it up through the bottom. Let me get a little closer. You see how I have that threaded through? And then you just pull it through. And then go to the next one and thread your yarn through. We're gonna go all the way around till we've threaded every single one of these. And you can thread through the top too if you want to, but I find it easier to do it through the bottom. You get the same result either way. Just whatever's easier for you. And they make needles that are a little bit curved at the tip, so they're just a little bit easier, but I'm actually not having any problems with this one. And I like how the looms have like the little groove that helps not only with the loom hook, it helps with the needle too. And what this is doing is it's going to make sure that once you take this off the loom, it's not going to all unravel. If you don't go through and thread through like this, the whole thing would unravel because there's nothing securing. Whoops, I just pulled the needle out. Okay, hold on a moment while I re-thread the needle. Technical difficulty. Coming up to the end. I know that because I see my anchor peg here, and I know I started over here, so I'm going to end here. So now all of these are threaded through, so I'm going to take my needle off. And at this point, you can take your loom hook and start pulling these over the pegs because we're going to take this off the loom. You just go all the way around. You're just releasing it from the pegs. You don't have to worry about it coming unraveled because we have that thread of yarn through there that's going to hold our stitches for us. And we're to the last one. And see, it's released from the loom. And here's our tube. Of course, when you're making a scarf, yours is going to be a lot longer. And I'm going to show you the difference between the stitches. The stitches look a little bit different between the loom and the knitting machine because the knitting machine has a much tighter knit to it. And I think there must be a squirrel outside because I hear my dog go again. See, this one turns out to be just a little bit wider, which means you're probably going to use a little bit more yarn to get it to the same length. And then, because the stitches are a little bit bigger, let me do a little bit more of a close-up for you. You still get your striping and everything. See, this is striping out really nice on the loom. It's making a really nice tube. Another thing, if you wanted it to be a little bit tighter, you could use two strands of yarn instead of just one. So basically you're holding two strands of yarn together and treating them like they're one. And then see how the bottom kind of was curling? That's all okay. And so I'm going to show you how you cinch the end. And I'm hoping this, I'm kind of hoping and kind of not hoping that this is going to mess up a little bit for me on this end because that happens sometimes. Let me show you how easy this will cinch together. This is the end that we finished with the loom that we just took off. I knew it. There has to be a squirrel out there. Hold on just a second. I'm going to go shut the door. That was exactly what it was, a squirrel. He has a thing against squirrels for some reason. So we're going to take this yarn, like this tail, and we're going to start pulling it. And I want you to see how it's like pulling all that together and kind of cinching it together at the ends. You just keep on pulling it. And see, if this was a hat, that would be how you would close the hat. You know, we just cinched that end. And see how it was really super easy to cinch? Well, I notice on the loom, at least for me, a lot of the times, the bottom doesn't want to cinch like that. It's really a pain. And I'm going to see if that happens to me here. Okay, it's going to happen. Okay. It doesn't want to cinch. It like will go so far, and then I almost feel like I'm going to break my yarn. So what I'm going to do with that, because I don't want to break my yarn, because this has happened to me before when I've made a tube scarf, is I pull, my yarn breaks, and then, you know, you're pretty much done. You know, it's over with. So I'm gonna thread some yarn through the bottom like I did the top. And see if this would be just a little hat. So I'm gonna cut off some yarn. And you may be lucky. Sometimes it goes through perfectly fine. I don't have any issues. And it cinches up perfect. And I never have that issue on the Addy, on the knitting machine. It always cinches up just fine. But I'm kind of glad this happened, because if it happens to you, then you know that all is not lost. So I'm gonna thread a needle, just like I did for the top. And I don't have the help of the loom, you know, holding all my stitches for me. So you can kind of just unravel, and you can see where the top stitch starts. You know, how you can just see the stitch there as you go around. I'm just gonna manually, myself, go through and thread through that bottom stitch. And there may be a better way of doing this. I'm not like a professional. These are just like tips that I've learned. And so see, I've got it through this one. And then I'm gonna go through, I'm gonna try to see if how many I can fit on my needle before I pull them through. I'm just taking that top stitch and hooking the needle. And of course it's gonna get harder over here where it did try to cinch some. You just have to kind of use your fingers and find the stitches. And if you miss a stitch or two, it's still gonna cinch for you. It's not the end of the world. Because I did a scarf with homespun yarn, and I had a really hard time finding my stitches, and I know I skipped a few, but it still cinched. I know I'm skipping some. Go ahead and pull my needle through a little. Because it's really hard to see the stitches on this side where it tried to cinch. I know I'm missing a couple, but hopefully it'll still. Okay, and see, I can see where I started, and here's the last one. So I'm gonna pull this the rest of the way. Okay. So I just manually took all, and you still have this guy over here. We're gonna get rid of him too. So now I'm just gonna, since I just threaded all those needles myself, I'm just gonna, or not needles, but stitches, I'm just gonna pull. And look, see, you just pull, and it cinched. So then you can just tie it off. So I'm going to tie this off. I'll make this be the tail, because it's not going to be as pretty as the front part. And then I'm going to take the tail that we started with, and I'm going to tie it to these ones just to get rid of him. And that helps cinch it the rest of the way up. And I'm gonna cut this a little bit shorter. I hope I'm not being confusing. I'm really sorry if I am. Because I'm gonna show you how to cinch again on another tube. Now, a tip for you, before I put these ends in, if you were making a headband, you would use 90 rows, and you would cinch both ends, and that would be a headband. That would be, and then what you would do is take your two ends, the two pieces of yarn from each of the ends, and you tie them together. So we'll make this one into a little headband, and I'll show you how to, see, you would just tie it tightly together, This is a very tiny headband, but pretend like it's 90 rows, and that'd be a headband. And you could put like a flower or anything you wanted here. You could even, you know, whip stitch it together a little bit more if you wanted to. But I'll show you how to hide these tails. I'm going to cut this one a little bit shorter. So this is a little bonus. Normally you would only have one piece of yarn on each side. The reason we have three over here is because of the way I had to cinch that end. And you probably could go ahead and cut off a couple of those. But I leave it a little bit longer just in case this would come unraveled. But then you take and you just go into one of these bottom areas and thread your needle up through the yarn. And kind of just poke it out a little bit further up. And then pull the yarn through. And then kind of pull it tight and then cut. And then when you pull this out, watch how that's going to disappear. See how it disappeared? And then you would do the same with this side over here. Only you've got three pesky pieces of yarn. Let me see if I can make those all thread through the needle by folding the yarn and pushing with a fingernail. And like I said, normally you would just have one. You just have, but the reason we have three is because we had to do that, the cinching ourselves, because it didn't want to cooperate. I'm kind of glad that happened, like I said, because then I could show you it's not the end of the world, you can fix it. See, now I have all three pieces through, but I'm going to do the same thing. I'm just going to go through the bottom, and I'm kind of holding the other side of the tube down here so I can make sure the needle doesn't go through the bottom, because I want it to come through up here. And then the same kind of thing. Take the needle off, cut it a little bit shorter, and then when you pull, that'll all disappear inside. And you can even flip it around to the other side. But this would be a headband if it was 90 rows. So there's a bonus. That's how to make a headband. It's just a tube. You cinch both ends, and then you tie it together. And then you have a headband. Or ear warmer. So, that's that. So let me show you how to finish this actual snake. And like I said, I wanted to get a video out to you quick, and I knew it would take me longer to finish doing the snake on the loom. So I've already got a tube here. This is just a tube, just like what you had on the loom. And so I'm going to finish off. I'm going to make one end of this is going to be my tail, the other is going to be the head. So I'm just going to go ahead and do the tail first. And so I'm just pulling, 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 and see as you pull, it just cinches the end up. So then what you're going to do is make sure the end stays cinched. So I'm going to thread my needle and I'm going to tie this off. And there's probably a lot of different ways to do this too. I am always afraid that my work is going to come apart, so I'm always like extra knotty. So I'm going to take my needle and see how it's the yarn's coming out on this side. I'm just going to take and poke my needle in and pull it up through that center. And then I'm just going to kind of keep doing that a couple of times. I'm pulling it nice and tight. Okay, now this time I'm going to knot it. So I'm not going to pull it all the way. I'm going to leave that little loop and put my needle through the loop. So this time it's going to actually make a knot. And sometimes you have to like kind of use your fingernails to pull it down. And I'm going to do it again, because like I said, I'm like always so scared my work's gonna come apart. Margaret says she and I are not heads, because we both like knots. I'm gonna do it one last time. I know, it's excessive. You probably would be perfectly safe with just one. And then I'm gonna do kind of like I did with the other one. I'm gonna take my needle and put it down back in the center. And pull, go up through, and come out somewhere up here. And then kind of pull it tight. You see when you pull it tight, you can see where it's pulled up. And then cut the yarn. And then watch when I pull, you'll see that yarn disappear. But it's up in there. So hold on a second. Sorry, I keep having a lot of interruptions. But see, then your tail's all done. That side's done. So now we're going to start with the head. And I'm not going to cinch it yet because I'm going to put the eyes on. So I'm going to pick out of my selection of eyes here. Now, eyes you can get at Hobby Lobby, or you can get them online. Joanne's only has one kind. So I think I'm going to pick green because I think green looks good. Now, I'll give you at least my own personal preference. There's the eyes, and then there's the washers that are plastic, like this. I'm trying to get it in frame. Anyway, they're plastic. There's also ones that come with metal eyes. The metal eyes work, but I don't like them that much because they're kind of hard to get on and they kind of hurt. The plastic ones I prefer, but if all I can find are eyes with metal, I'll use them. So I'm gonna get my eyes. You just kind of lay it out and see where you think the eyes would go. And kind of just poke them through only the first layer of the yarn. Right now I'm just kind of figuring out where I want to put them. Okay. I like them in that placement. So kind of hold on to them a little bit and fold this inside out where you can see where the eyes are poking through. And then I'm going to put the washers on. See, the plastic washers are so much easier. I'm going to show you another tip, except I have to go grab them. Hold on a sec. I'm so unprofessional, I know. I got these from Amazon, this brand here. They were really cheap, and I keep the box because these puppies are sharp. But these are like little craft cutters, and the tips of these eyes are kind of pokey, just right at the very tip. So I just snip just the very tip. Normally I do this over the trash can, because the tip's gonna go flying. And it did. But that's what vacuums are for, right? But I just snip just the tip. I leave plenty of the rest of the eye, but just snipping the tip off keeps it from poking out through the other side. Or if it does poke through, it's not sharp. I mean, I can press my fingers as hard as I want and it doesn't hurt. So now I got my eyes on. Put some stuff up real quick. Well, nope, I need that still. So the next thing I'm going to do is go ahead and make the tongue. I always say I'm going to make a whole bunch of these things up, but I never do. I just use Red Heart Worsted Weight Super Saver because this giant thing is like $3. And I'm just going to pull out a length about, I don't know how long that is, but about that long. Not too long, not too short. And I'm going to make a chain stitch. First thing I'm going to do is make a slip knot. And put my crochet hook through. And if you don't know how to do a chain stitch for crochet, there's a lot of videos out there. I'm not the most perfect at crochet yet, so I just do my own thing. But I'm going to make 8 chains. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then pull the yarn through. So then I've got 8 chains, and I'm just going to pull it tight. And then on the end that had my slip stitch, I cut and leave just a tiny little bit of yarn on the end, you know, like a little point to the snake's tongue. And then I've got this long piece because that's what I'm going to use to put it on here. So I'm going to start pulling the yarn so I can cinch it. So I would suggest if you're making a snake with the loom, that the head part you use where you took it off of the loom, because you know that's going to cinch, and it's going to cinch really nicely. Whereas the other side, if you run into that problem that I did where it would not cinch, it's not as clean, but that's the tail, so you're able to hide that. So I'm pulling, because I want to cinch it so I can kind of see where I want to place the tongue, you know, by looking at his little face. So I'm going to put the tongue about here. So I'm not going to finish cinching it shut yet. I'm going to go ahead and put the tongue on, and I'm going to hook him about right there. So again, I thread my needle. And then right there where I said I was going to put the tongue, I'm just going to, and see, I'm just only going through one, like one stitch. And I'm going to pull it through and then go through again and knot it on. You know, just basically one knot. Then I'm going to take, and I'm going to do the tail of this tongue like I do everything else. I'm going to take my needle and go up through the tube and come out. I usually go a little bit above, like where his forehead would be, pull the needle out, and kind of make it, you know, cinch it up tight, and then cut. And then you'll see when I pull again, that'll disappear. So that disappears, but then your tongue is still on there. So now I'm going to finish cinching. And just be mindful of the tongue. And see how the tongue is there? And I've just cinched it as tight as it'll go. And so now I'm going to do just like I did with the tail end. And tie this off. So I'm going to thread my needle again. And do just like I did with the tail, being mindful of the tongue, and just go through kind of the center. You know, it's just your own personal preference how you tie yours off and how many knots you do. And I'm just going to keep doing the same thing, kind of like I did with the tail, just going back and forth. Now I'm going to start tying my knots. So looping through you know, leaving a loop and then running the, kind of like sewing when you tie a knot. But since I'm a knot head, I'm gonna probably do about three of them. And my last knot, I kind of come up a little bit through the tongue, on the bottom of the tongue. Oops. Or I drop the needle, because it's like an extra little security to hold the tongue on, which I don't think the tongue is going anywhere, but like I said, I'm a knot head. I love how Margaret said that. That's what I always refer to myself now. So there's my last knot. So then I'm gonna poke it through and hide the tail again. Just kind of come up through your tube, and you can kind of feel along the back to make sure the needle doesn't come through the back. And then poke it up. Looks like a little Muppet. And then I'm going to cut the yarn. And then when you pull, the yarn disappears. And then you just kind of straighten his little head out. And there's his little face with his little tongue. And he's done. This is a completed snake scarf. That's it. Some people, instead of using the eyes, they use buttons and just sew the buttons on. I've seen a lot of people that do the buttons. It's really cute. Sometimes they'll use like a larger white button and then a smaller black button. So it looks like you have, you know, your iris and pupil. And so those turn out really cute. But so there's the tail, there's the head, and then the whole middle. And that's it. That's a snake. Now, I've had some people talk about making them into like draft catchers or draft dodgers, or, you know, the things that you put down in front of your doors or whatever. And so you could stuff it with polyfill. I think it would take a lot of polyfill. Like, if you don't want it to be a scarf and you want it to be a toy, you can stuff it with polyfill. And then the other day somebody had asked, did I think that you could stuff it with rice or beans? Because their son wanted one, but they wanted it to feel more beany. And I figured the beans or rice for sure would come through the knit. And since the knit on the loom is a little bit wider, I think even beans would come through. But so I was telling my husband, I was thinking, you know, how could you stuff one with rice or beans? And he said, well, what about pantyhose? Which is an amazing idea. You know, pantyhose are a pair of tights, and they're already a tube. You know, like, you would take one leg and stuff it however you wanted to, whatever you wanted to stuff it with, and then tie a knot in the end, and then you could just stuff it inside the tube before you cinched the ends up, and then you would have like more of a Beanie Baby kind of feel. So I thought that was a really good idea. I haven't tried it out. I might, though, especially for, you know, like a toy or something. One funny thing to tell you is, if you do use beans, don't ever let it get wet because they will sprout. So anyway, let me get pan back up real quick. Okay, I hope that you found that helpful. And I hope I wasn't too confusing or rambly or whatever, because I don't think I'm the best at making tutorials, but I had a couple of requests, and I really wanted to help out, and so I hope that helps. And if you have any questions, hopefully I can answer them. You can either send me a private message, or you can make a comment down in the comment box, because then if you have questions, maybe it's the same kind of question somebody else has, and then if they're reading through the comments, they can get their answers there. So I really hope this helped, and good luck with your snake scarves. And if you make videos and you make a snake scarf, I would love to see it. And that's it. I really, really hope this helped, and I'll talk to you next time. Bye!